Welcome to the South Florida Saltwater Fishing Report. I'm Heath, and it's time to get into the bite. All right, folks, here we are. The one-stop shop, the only place where you can get everything about local fishing that you need to know. We're going to cover what's biting, who's catching it, where it's biting. We're also going to go over that weekly weather forecast, the future forecast, the moon phase, the tide charts, all that goodness. Before we get into this though, if you want to learn more about fishing, grow as an angler, just see some great and exciting offshore fishing adventures, you can start by hitting the subscribe button and joining the South Florida Saltwater Fishing family. All right, folks, we had an exciting weekend with great weather. We got a ton to go over, some excellent catches. Some fish are on fire right now, but first we're going to start with our local news. And the first thing we got is some notices from the FWC, of course, our friends. And what we got going on right here is, we touched basically on it last week. We got a closure of the Atlantic State Waters Amberjack, closed from April 1st to April 30th. So they're shut down for a month while it's a spawning season. So there we go with that. And the next one is something that most people should already know about if you are into lobster. And that is that lobster season is done for the rest of the year until the mini season. And then October comes, lobster season's done, folks. Hope you got them while you could. If you are into lobster, make sure you have that endorsement on your fishing license if you do go for lobster. All right, so that's that. Lobster's done. Amberjack's closed for a little bit, but not the end of the world. Hey, there's always other stuff, right? Yeah, that's what I say. Okay, so let's get into our fishing report. We're going to pull up some notes real quick right here. And we're going to go over the inshore bite real quick, which is, you know, not real active this week, but I did have a few reports. I got a nice little picture here of a mangrove snapper, a little night bite going on. So let me see if I can pull that up right here real quick. There we go. All right. Mangrove snapper. This was sent in by Ernest. Shared a nice little thing. He went down to Marathon. There we go. Awesome. Nice little grab right there. Like I said, night bite. So that's the only thing I really had about the inshore fishing. But I can tell you right now that pompano are starting to show up good. Up north, there's biting. That's further up north. And we've also got snook and tarpon. Tarpon season is in effect, so they're starting to really fire up. And if you get them, you know, just beware, the sharks are out there. Hammerheads love tarpon. So if you get one hooked up, just beware getting in the boat, you know, unless you're looking to feed them to the sharks. Also, bonefish down south in the flats, the bonefish are hitting. So if you've got that shrimp or flies or whatever, and you're into bonefishing, fire that baby up. Go get them. All right, so that's our intro report. Not much going on right there. However, I did, we're going to keep going on. We're going to hit the reef right now. But before we hit the reef, I want to show you something that I, this is something spectacular. I'm going to show you this right now. I'm calling this the catch of the week. Bear with me and let me find it. This is, this guy caught two fish on one jig. This is Gary Almata. He sent this in, and I'm going to expand it right here and show it to you. He's got a mutton snapper and a red grouper on one jig. This is a great catch. I mean, looks like a keeper mutton, and the red grouper, I believe it was out of season when he caught it. So, hey, still, solid catch. Catch of the week right there, folks. It don't get no better than that. Two different species. The red would have been a keeper if he's in season, but hey, solid. Good job on that one. And, you know, don't get no better. All right, let's move on. Booking right through this. We are on the reef now. We're talking about the reef. We got the mangrove snapper, like I just showed you. That's an inshore bite, probably over the grass flats or, you know, fishing off the dock or something. But we got more reef fish going on. Ciro mackerel, same guy. Ernest sending us in another nice little Ciro. So interesting story about Ernest here, and I want to thank him for sharing. And he shared his story. He said he went down to a marathon. They were fishing the humps, didn't get much, so they headed inshore and they got this nice little cirro right there. You know, bunch of fun, ton of fun right there. So marathon, he said the bite wasn't that hot, so we got to keep that. But I am going to tell you that I got a different conflicting report from Key Largo where the offshore bite seemed to be steady. So let's keep moving on. Our yellowtail are still biting, obviously. As you saw, we've got cirro. Cirros and yellowtails are always mixed in together. So if you're in that 60, 70 foot on a ledge range, chum, make sure you've got current. Get out there and get them fish while they're biting. Also, we've got a solid mutton snapper bite still. So let's see what we've got going on with the mutton snapper. I know we've got some great pictures here. Here we go. Solid mutton snap. Trying to get my picture to open up. There we go. Blam. This is from Sean. Sean is up in Stewart. He went out on a drift boat and got this. This is nice. Solid mutton snapper right there. So, you know, thank you for sending it in. Great pick. And then we are going to show you also another mutton snapper bite here. That's off Fish City Pride out of Pompano Beach. Now also on top of this fired up mango, on top of this fired up mutton snapper bite, the muttons are still solid. They have been for quite a while now, and the bite really never dropped off throughout the winter, which is great. Hopefully it will keep up. We've also got solid cobia bite happening. Look at that monster. Again, this is on the same, this is a drift boat out of Pompano Beach. They head out of Hillsborough. This is the Fish City Pride. Captain Skip Dana, Captain Dwight, whomever you want to go out. These are two captains that actually care if you're catching fish. They are not the guy that just sits and drifts and goes, ah, hey, whatever happens, happens. So same drift, right? These guys got another one. Two cobia on the same 4-hour section of fishing. Great bite right there. Let's see if I can show you their haul for that day. Maybe I can. Yes, I can. Here we go. This is their haul. There you go. Look, they actually pulled three cobias, couple of kings, couple of other little goodies. Look at the mutton right there that you saw, some yellowtail. So that's a solid reef bag right there. That's some great reef fishing. And like I said, the captains on the Fish City Pride care if you catch fish. All right, so let's move on. What else is hitting on the reef? That was some solid fishing. And like I said, I've fished on the Fish City Pride for quite a few years back in the day. Not really anymore because I got my own boat and it costs more than fishing on there. So we've also got a, here we go, let me see. We've got big permit down in Marathon. Captain Alex owns a little charter. Let me find it here. We're gonna go here. He owns a charter business down in Marathon. So if you're looking for it, you can always hit me up and I can give you, here we go. Let me expand that real quick. Permit down in Marathon. Big one too. Hold on, let me show you the screen. Here we go, bam, look at that. Nice, solid catch. So if you're into permit fishing and you wanna have fun, he does all sorts of stuff, offshore, inshore. You know, he'll take you and find the fish that you wanna get into. If you're into targeting specific things, you just, you know, let him know your intentions and there you go. Great catch, giant permit right there. All right. So that is our reef fishing right now. All of the species are fired up on the reef. It's springtime, folks. We're a couple of weeks into it, and it's only going to get better as the weather starts to warm up. Now, however, we are looking at El Nino dissipating and forming into La Nina in the coming months, more likely. That is what they're forecasting. So we're going to have to watch that. What does La Nina do? La Nina forms Atlantic hurricanes. Bad for us. But the fishing after the hurricanes is always great. So, you know, there's a plus side. There's always a silver lining with crappy weather. Following it, it stirs up the sands. The fish are hungry. They get into the bite and it makes it exciting. But, you know, hurricanes, especially if they're bad, mess up lots of people's programs. Regardless, let's move on. Deep dropping. We got vermilion. Definitely vermilions. I got a picture right here. Hold on. I know that I got a solid picture of a great catch with the vermilion. This is Dennis. Dennis fishes out of Boynton, I believe. Yes, here we go. Solid, you know, not too many of them, but definitely a good shot of some beeliners. If you know the little nickname for vermilion snapper, there we go. Blam. Going home with great dinner. One of my favorite snapper to eat is the vermilion snapper. Cold water, not fishy at all. They're not running around eating fish all day. They're eating the stuff that's down a couple hundred feet. Vermilion are caught in 200 to 300, typically off structure. You got to find them, drift for them, and kind of watch where they're going because they move. They don't just sit in one place, but they do school, which is good. All right, let's move forward. That is the deep drop bite. Also, black-bellied rosefish, they're always swimming around. So if you ain't got nothing to do and you're getting skunked and you're out there, if you've got that electric reel, head out to 800 feet off in between Pompano, in between Hillsborough Inlet, Boca Inlet, 800 feet. Look for the big wide open areas on your GPS where the contour lines are not packed together. Go there, drop out, you will get the roses. Also, we have a swordfish bite that is still very consistent. So if you're into sword fishing, don't be shy, get out there, drop a line and see if you can get one. You know, the one thing I always say about sword fishing when people want to do it is that, you know, I really hope you like heartbreak. Swordfish is very tricky fish, especially right when you get to the boat. That's where most people lose them. So, and if you've never done it and you're thinking about doing it, I suggest finding someone who has experience. Otherwise, it's going to be a long road to glory. All right, let's move on. Now we're going to get into the trolling, which is, it's spring. You should literally be trolling that deep reef and a little bit out further, starting to look for the pelagics. Trolling is going to be where it's at. But then again, if you're a solid reef person and you love your snappers, like I said, the reef is on fire right now. So let's hit this up. Let me see what we got here. First things first, black fin tuna are still swimming around. I'm going to show you. I know this picture. This is Mike. He's from St. Lucie. He's a great fisherman, man. He gets all the species, but this is a black fin that he got the other day. So, you know, the black fin are still, they're all up and down the coast right now. This is, like I said, St. Lucie, but they're from the Keys all the way north. So you just got to get out off that deep reef, get out off the ledges, and go get them. Also, I got another interesting thing that I saw, which kind of blew my mind. There was somebody here, I'm going to show you this post real quick, that this gentleman caught two yellowfin tuna off Pompano Beach. And I had to question it. I said, you caught that in these waters? Because I'm used to seeing them out in... This is Christopher Evans. I'm going to show you the picture right here. Let me bring it up. He caught two. They're not giant yellow fins, but they're yellow fins. And it blew my mind. I thought they were usually typically more towards the Bahamas, but bang, right there, yellow fin tuna. And you can see the shoreline in the background. So it's not like he's in 1,000 feet of water. Solid catch. Very rare for these waters. You don't see that much, which is great. Hey, man, more power to him. So there we go, and I believe, yeah, yellowfin tuna off Pompano Beach. Solid catch. So there we go. Now, what else do we got? Speaking of tuna, here we go. This is Thad. Oh, man, he went, this is from down in the Keys. He went and had a great trip down in the Keys. Blackfin tuna, many species. What else is swimming around on the reef? We've got our dolphin. Same gentleman, Thad. He went out with his sons. Out in the Keys, let me see where he said he went. This is Key Largo. So the Key Largo tuna dolphin bite, nice. That's a solid double digit dolphin right there. Look at that. And then this guy's trip down to the Keys was great. Look at it. They also got black grouper over the reef, another fish. So, but the grouper are closed right now, but still in May, you get a fish like that, man, you're going home with dinner. Solid, nice black grouper. I mean, this guy's trip to the Keys was excellent. Some of the last three pictures I've showed you are definitely from that. And here's another dolphin that he caught on that same trip. Look at that. So the dolphin, the blackfin tuna, the rare yellowfin tuna. For some reason, they're swimming around in our waters here off the Tri-County area, which is great. I mean, man, you can't get better than that. And at the end for his, oh, he even got some lobster before the season closed. Hey, perfect. Like I said, last chance for romance on those guys. Lobster is done. But hey, here we go. Perfect. These guys had a great trip. They slayed the dolphin left and right. So that shows you the mahi are in full force right now. Can't go out and get him. Let me see where he said. If he says dolphin, mahi, 250 feet, trolling. Let me see if he says another one. Blackfin tuna, 175. Another mahi, 775, almost 800 feet. So they're in shallow, they're out deep. Another mahi, 255. So sharing the information, where you got it, how deep you were. Hey, excellent. We know they're swimming around. You just got to find them. It's good that they're not locked in one zone. You know, that gives everyone a chance. Those people are very adventurous. And here he is. That's his trip finale. You know, a couple of dolphin guys after the day is done. Excellent catch. Excellent trip for Thad, man. And, you know, great sharing of that trip right there. Nothing like it. And he's got a little kookarooski going on right there, man. Excellent, excellent, excellent. Great day for the guys. Thad, and it looks like his sons, I believe. If I'm wrong, but that's what it looks like. Looks like family photo to me. All right, so we got our blackfin. Also, the king mackerel are in effect. Here we go. This is Mike Alt. He caught this. There we go. Nice kingster right there. I believe... not sure where he got that bad boy. Really didn't say so. Let me see if he wrote anything about it. But definitely kingfish. Nope, he didn't write where he got it. Speaking of dolphin, we'll keep with the dolphin. This is James. Solid dolphin out of Boynton. Right here. These dolphin are showing up big. So when you're first getting your dolphin season in, the schoolies are darn good size, man. Look at these guys going on. All right. He also had, on the same trip, he caught a wahoo. So your wahoo bite is still happening. Look at this wahoo going on here. Not a monster, but hey, a wahoo's a wahoo, right? That's what they say in Hawaii. And that is where the name came from. Wahoo is not just somebody screaming, wahoo, because we got a fish. No, wahoo is named from the island Oahu. That's where they started catching them, and that's how they got their name. All right. And let me see. I know I got another kingfish pick somewhere around here. All right. I know where to find it. I can find my kingfish on this. This is the South Florida Saltwater Fishing Report page. There we go. Look at that kingster right there. Bam. Another one. This is from Joseph. He said he caught this. This is out of Hillsborough Inlet. 130 feet of water. Excellent. He took that picture and sent it and posted it right on. Said he got a pink and white sea witch, squirt squid, and bonita strip on a number 6 planer. Excellent information sharing right there. So, you know, the planer trolling, the wahoo, the king mackerel, the dolphin, the tuna, everything, like I said, is on fire. The dolphin are going to be out there. So if you're not finding them in close, make sure you go and get them out there. They're biting everything. We've got it. Like I said, we had a very eventful week. The weather was perfect from it starting in Saturday afternoon. Sunday was beautiful, and we headed all the way out, into today. And now the wind's going to start picking up, and I'll get to that in a moment. Let me show you this. We got a sailfish also. Sailfish are still biting. They're still here. So if you want to, you know, target them, go on ahead. It might be an incidental catch, but bear with me. I'll pull this up here real quick. Love seeing some sailfish catches, man. You can't ever complain about that. Here we are back to the South Florida Saltwater Fishing Report. Let me find this. There we go. Mike Alt again. Man, he was lacing into him this weekend. Nice sailfish. Great catch. So, you know, got some consistency here with the information sharing. Got to thank Thad. Got to thank Mike Alt. Got to thank, put on a ton of them. Mike Long. Christopher Evans, James Montgomery, and Daniel. He's got a YouTube channel too, if you ever want to check it out. So excellent information. Let me see what else we got going on here, if I can find anything for us to share. Like I said, oh, we got another dolphin pick. Just want to show you that here real quick. This is Juan Rubio. He works on Killing Time Charters, which is the Texas Wireline, Captain Tommy Oberlin. Nice, solid bull dolphin right there, hitting it up for the customers. What else do we got here that I can show you? Mutton Snapper, the Cobia Bite was on fire. We got the Bolo out of Deerfield Beach. Just real quick on them. They're a great boat. If you ever want to head out and get into, you know, they work with their customers great. Solid Wahoo bite for them. Like I'm going to show you real quick. I mean, just Wahoo after Wahoo. Wahoo's all day long for them. Wahoo's good to go. The Bolo, right? Great boat, great fishing boat. If you ever are looking for a charter, you know, I recommend them. There's Rebound Sport Fishing. There's Killing Time Charters. If you're into drift fishing, like I said, go on and hit up the Fish City Pride. All righty. Okay, so that about does it for our fishing report, folks. Hope you got something out of that. Man, the fishing is on fire right now. Now let's head into our weather report. The weather report is tomorrow. It's going to be damn hot. It's going to be 90 degrees tomorrow. But we have a cool front coming in starting tomorrow night. It should be heading in. There's some horrible weather up north right now. The folks in Ohio, down into Tennessee, they're going to be facing some tornadoes, so hope for the best for them when it comes to that. But that is going to be pushing some weather our way. Well, won't be much of a weather event, but we are going to get a little bit of wet stuff, but not much. But starting tomorrow night, we're going to have cooler weather push through. But tomorrow during the day, it's going to be a real heat event. We're starting to get warm again. All right, so let's look at Wendy and start getting into our weather report. All right, so right now, let's zoom in a little bit. We got winds in the high teens, low 20s, everywhere. West Coast, East Coast, all the way up the coast, a little bit of a higher spot right here, some gusts and stuff. Not much going on, but that is our current outlook. So let's look tomorrow, see what happens. Yep, you see? So when this front starts pushing through, we're going to have southerly winds all over. West Coast, East Coast, you're going to have winds in the mid-20s, steady. Gusts probably a little bit higher tomorrow night. Yeah, same thing. The wind starts pushing from the southwest. Again, driving that front. There we go. Thursday, there we go. There's our northwest wind with our front coming through. Going to be breezy out there. Again, not too bad. It'll be west, so we might have a little bit of the seas starting to lay down. If we're looking at our wind, we'll figure that out. Thursday afternoon, the winds look like they start to dissipate down here in the Biscayne area. Up here in Tri-County, not so much. Vero up north, Palm Bay and everything, you're still getting, you got a strong west wind. Down on the west coast, Marco Island, Naples, Chokoloskee, it's, you got a wind coming from the west, so you're going to have a very choppy outlook out there. Not very favorable. Let's head into Friday morning. There we go. We still got a northwest wind. So the west side of Florida, you're not on the leeward side of the peninsula when it comes to that wind. You're going to have some chop, especially coming from the north. Same thing over here. We zoom in, it looks like we're a little bit protected. So we've got the winds less, low teens inshore. But as you can see, the lighter color. But as you head out and you get into the stream, it looks like the wind, it's going to get breezy. So that'll probably follow suit with your waves. Let's look at Friday afternoon. Look at this, we calm down. We've even got a dead spot here in Key Largo where there's going to be no wind. Up and down the coast, you are protected by the state, but as you get further off. So the low-lying winds are gonna lay down. Again, on the west coast, Naples, Marco Island, Chokoloskee, the Everglades National Park, all the way down to Key West, Lower Keys, Marathon, everything. You've got that wind just coming straight at you. Looks right around 10 miles an hour. Not bad, but you know, you gotta bear with it. We'll see what the waves are gonna do here momentarily. Friday evening, it starts ripping again. Saturday morning, we got another northwest wind. So that's going to disturb everything. Inshore, it's a little less. Offshore, out in the stream, over towards, as you head towards Freeport, it picks up and gets up into the 20s. So that's what it's looking like. The weather forecast is looking iffy. Gonna have to play it by ear. And as we go into Saturday afternoon, again, we start calming down. So Friday afternoon, Saturday afternoon, the afternoons are looking like you might get a little lull and break in the wind. Again, here, Saturday afternoon, look at that. 0 miles an hour here, Miami, Key Largo, Isla Mirada. Over on the West Coast, you got some little Chokoloskee area, you know, Everglades National Park. You got a little bit of goodness going on there. As we head north up into Palm Beach and further north, we get back into the windy stuff. It'll be blowing. Sunday, all right, and then Saturday evening, the wind starts in, picking up again. Let's see, Sunday morning. Yep, we start heading from the northeast Sunday morning. Not bad down around Miami, offshore, off Key Largo. Got a little weird dead spot there. Out on the west side, that's when they become the leeward side of the peninsula. So their waves and their chop might lay down a little bit because of that factor, which is good. So we've got that little bit of, shift in the wind after the front passes through. And we'll have cooler temperatures these days all the way pretty much probably through Sunday. And then it'll probably start warming up again. Sunday, heading into the late morning, our winds start shifting to a more easterly. And then Sunday afternoon, we lay down over on the West Coast. We got some dead stuff. We are in the below 10 miles an hour zone here, Tri-County area. Vero Beach, Cocoa Beach, all that. Yeah, it's about the same, right around 10 miles an hour, maybe a little less. Monday morning, we're pulling from the east again. We got an east wind in the low teens. As we cross the state and we get into the Gulf, it tends to pick up. Monday afternoon, looks like our wind's starting to pick up. Monday evening, yep, we're picking up a little bit more. Let's see if we zoom out. We got some dead stuff over here as we head up north on the west side towards Tampa, Sarasota, but that is not really our zone. We'll see what happens here as we move further into Monday night, same thing. Tuesday morning, yep, we're still pulling as you go up north. We got some circulation going on out here, out towards Bermuda. Don't know what that's all about. And Tuesday night, yeah, it's still pulling. So Monday and Tuesday is probably going to be a long shot. Now let's go on ahead and turn to our waves. Let's go back to Tuesday where we are right now. Right now, if you are fishing over in the Bahamas, it looks pretty. Right now, we got a nice calmness down in Everglades National Park, Chokoloskee, West End, Naples, Marco Island, good to go. And all up and down the coast, it's not real bad. Looks about 2 feet, 3 feet. Tri-County area up in the Vero starts picking up a little bit, but that's today. Let's look at tomorrow. Tomorrow morning, we got waves coming from the south. Biscayne Bay looks nice. West area, you know, nice and calm right in there. A little bit of chop, nothing. As you head further up north on the west end, you're going to start getting some seas. 2 to 4 feet. Looks like that, and that follows suit. Up inshore, up north, as you head into St. Lucie County and all that, Vero Beach, Fort Pierce, it looks like you'll be less than 2 feet. Tri-County area, 2 feet, 2 to 4, some chop. So if you're heading out tomorrow, that's what you're looking at. Tomorrow afternoon, it's going to pick up out here. That don't look pretty. All right, let's head into Thursday. Thursday, we are looking at, again, Biscayne Bay is looking pretty inshore. Look at this. So if you look inshore, within the 3 nautical mile line, it looks not bad. We got waves heading to the west, to the northwest. So that's Thursday. We've got this, the front is actually going to have already probably pushed through, which should bring some milder weather going on. Can't really complain about that. So if you're inshore fishing, you know, probably fishing that deep reef, maybe even getting out to 400 or 500, trying to track down some mahi. That doesn't look too bad. That's Thursday. And again, like I said, you know, this area is always light. Let's look at the lower Keys. At a west end of Key West Marathon, out in the back country, it's looking pretty. Over down on the out in the Atlantic, though, not so much. All righty, let's move on to Thursday afternoon. Thursday afternoon, it looks like we have a let up, especially offshore. Like I said, this more turquoise area, that is seas looking 1 to 2 feet Thursday. Let's head into Friday morning. Friday morning, again, the more calm seas tend to be more inshore. Down here, West Coast, Keys, same stuff. Key Largo down to Marathon actually looks all right out in the Atlantic for Friday. And if we head into the afternoon, definitely going to lay down Friday afternoon. We've got a very confused sea Friday. Look at this. When you see this, let me zoom in. You've got waves that are curling around here. This is a confused sea. So the further you get out as you head into the stream, your waves are going to be coming at you in multiple directions. So just be wary of that. However, inshore, within, you know, the 4 or 5 mile mark, you're definitely good to go. Those seas are going to be less than 2 feet, it looks like, I would say, according to our color chart here. So Friday's looking like a nice day. But again, when we looked at our wind, so let me just go back to that Friday afternoon. The winds are looking like they're calming down in the afternoons, right? So we've got this circulation starting to happen. That's our wind. And then we look at our waves, it follows suit. So our afternoon fishing and getting offshore is looking more like that's going to be more favorable, especially if you're in a smaller craft. Saturday, Biscayne Bay. Up north, we've got, you know, the less than 2 foot stuff. West Coast, following suit. Tri-County area, you got a confused sea. We've got waves coming from the west, though. So maybe not, but maybe a choppy swell going on Saturday afternoon. Again, we've got that confused sea happening, and it looks like it lays down a little bit to, you know, 2 feet or less in the afternoon. Let's look at our wind again and Saturday afternoon. Yeah, we got that dead spot, and we got wind shifting, which is what's going to mess with your seas. So sometimes that can do funky things to fishing, too, with pressure changes and everything. So just be wary of that if you are heading out on the weekend. Sunday morning, we're looking at 2 to 4. Tri-County area, as we head down to Miami and into the Keys, looks like it gets nicer. So if you're heading south, man, over the weekend, you'll probably be able to get out and have some fun. Over on the West Coast, again, laying down flat, we've got waves coming from the northeast, however. So this might be a swell. We'll check what NOAA says here in a moment and figure that out. All right, Sunday afternoon, again, starts laying down. This is the pattern that's happening this week, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. In the afternoons, it lays down. On the West Coast, you're looking like beautiful stuff all the way up. Sarasota, Tampa, Northport, Cape Coral, everything, we're good to go. Down in the lower Keys, you've got some beautiful weather happening down there. So if you are heading down south and you're getting there, man, that's the way to go. Monday, West Coast, you know, same thing. Chokoloskee, 10,000 Islands, Naples. The west side is good, Everglades National Park. But as we head over on our East Coast, we are looking at some, you know, 2 to 4, definitely solid 2 to 4. But again, we've got a northeast, what could possibly be a swell going on. We'll have to check what they say. So you have to look at your webcams and figure out if that's a swell or if that's chop coming in. Again, you look at that webcam. If you've got breakers coming over your jetty, I don't think you should be going. All right, this is Monday afternoon. It lays down a little bit. Tuesday, same stuff. 2 to 4. West Coast, good. Down south, picking up. So heading into early next week, not looking so favorable. Later in this week, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, if you got the ability, those are probably your days you're looking at, you know, more favorable weather to get offshore. All right, now we're going to head back and let's look at our precipitation. Love looking at the rain. All right, let's zoom out. So right now, today, nada. Let's look at tomorrow morning. Oh, here's that front coming through like I told you. So there's that front. Tomorrow, this is 5 a.m. There's the front. It's like I said, it shouldn't be too much of a weather thing for us. So we've got some rain. This is 11 a.m. Wednesday, 6 p.m. Wednesday, where it's in the Tampa, Orlando area coming through. At night, it's going to push through. That's midnight right there. Thursday starts, it has a, you know, it's pretty much offshore. We might have a little bit of moisture in the early morning down in Miami over the Keys. Down in Chuckalusky area, Everglades National Park. Thursday afternoon, it looks like it's pushing off, and then we head into drier, cooler air. We've got some jet stream activity here doing some funky stuff. That's what's going to happen with our waves too. Friday, not much going on. That's that front pulling away. Still Friday afternoon. Saturday, not much. We've got a, there's something going on out here where we saw some circulation, but that's really got nothing. That's, you know, hundreds of miles away from us here. Back to our local area. Dry pretty much all day Saturday. Sunday, dry. Monday, we got those winds that are going to start picking up early next week. Like I said, from the east. So they'll be blowing east, actually, easterly winds from the west. So, and Tuesday, again, dry. So we're looking at dry. So our rain event will be happening Wednesday night into early Thursday. Look for that. That'll be your wet stuff. And then starting Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, it's not going to be, you know, the best situation for getting offshore, but it'll be doable. So just keep that in mind. All right, let's head over. Let's look at our winds real quick. Pull this up. Again, trying to bang this out real quick, folks. I know people got stuff to do. All right, here we go. Right now we are looking at teens right now. Tomorrow, looking into high teens, heading into the 20s. There we go. Wind direction right now is northeast. It's shifting all over. Tomorrow, wind's going to shift from the slight is the south-southeast. Then Thursday, we've got the wind shifting again from the west to the northwest, back to southwest. That's when our, as the front pushes through, that's why you've got that anomaly where it's going to change and shift all over the place as the front pushes through, and then you get the high pressure on the other side of the front. Front's the low pressure. On the other side of the front is the high pressure that drives it. All right, low teens, dipping down. Friday, it's going to, in the afternoon, drops down to 3 miles an hour. So like I said, in the afternoons, we're going to start seeing these slowdowns. Same thing Saturday morning. It's pushing in the morning, 10, low double digits, and then it drops down in the afternoon. Sunday, same thing. Sunday actually looks a little bit better for your wind in the morning than the other days afternoon. Monday, we start getting into the high double digits, the teens again. Tuesday, same thing. All right, so there's our wind from WindFinder, and yeah, it's jiving with what Wendy was showing us. All right, let's hit up NOAA real quick, see what they're telling us. Our favorite folks from NOAA who love to shut down our fisheries, even though it's not their fault. All right, small craft advisory in effect today through Thursday afternoon. Maybe what we're doing here is right, folks. Okay, yes, 2025, 2 to 4. I don't believe the winds are blowing 20 to 25 right now, but maybe they are way offshore. Wednesday, they're saying 25 to 30, gusts around 35, seas 5 to 7, occasionally to 9 feet. Period of 5 seconds. Wednesday, that's when the front's going to be pushing through later. So you're going to have those, it's going to get windy in front of it, obviously. Wednesday night, the wind shift to the west. So, yeah, it's going to be windy all the way through Wednesday night. And again, that period of those waves should start lengthening. Thursday, west northwest, seas 2 feet or less. Interesting. That doesn't agree with what our other folks were saying. Thursday night picks up again. Friday, northwest winds 15 to 20, around 10 knots in the evening, seas 2 to 3 feet along. This kind of goes along with that. I think the seas might be a little bit less Friday throughout the day. Saturday, northwest winds 10 to 15. Again, seas 2 to 3. So this kind of agrees with what we were seeing on Windy. And they're saying, and as we saw, that inshore was a little bit more subdued as you got out further into the Gulf, which is what this saying, 6 footers out into the Gulf. So Sunday, northeast winds 10 to 15, seas 3 to 5. Again, we saw from Windy, which I think is a little bit more accurate than NOAA, that Sunday that inshore might be okay, doable, and offshore definitely, you know, it's going to pick up. All right, so that's what NOAA has to say about everything. You can take from NOAA what you want to. Sometimes they're right, but then again, sometimes they're wrong. All right, let's blast this out. Let's head to the moon phase. Love our moon phase, especially when it comes to certain species like wahoo. Okay, here we are, folks. Right now, today, we are at a 46% moon. We are waning. Again, moon phase. Waning means we are heading away from the full moon. Waxing means we are heading towards a full moon. So this is today. We're at about a half moon. Tomorrow, April 3rd, 35%. We are heading towards the dark side of the moon. Come on, I don't need that. This would be Thursday, 25% moon, going dark. So if you're getting out there and you're looking to go do some bait fishing, get them gogs, it might be tricky because of the weather. That's not going to agree with you, but hey, they'll be out there biting. No moon, great bait fishing. Bait fish hide under the cover of darkness. All right, so Friday, 8%, Saturday, this is actually Sunday. Saturday, 8%. Sunday, 2%. So Monday, we're looking at zero moon. And then we start heading into our waxing phase again. So our moon is good. In some points, it's going to help the fish not feed all night because the bait fish will be out. Again, like I said, hiding under the cover of darkness. And that's what we like when our fish are hungry. So again, just to recap, we're looking at Friday, Saturday, Sunday-ish. The weather's going to push through. Wednesday, Thursday might be doable because we're going to be following that front. So Thursday, remember, Thursday morning will be the tail end of the front, maybe starting in the afternoon. All right, now let's look at our tide charts, and then we can rock and roll and let everybody move on with life. Here we go, tide charts. Where are we right now? In the morning today, we had an outgoing, a falling tide, and around 9 o'clock, it went slack, and then it started raising. So we're like right in the middle of a weird cycle, but I think as we head towards, remember our chart always shifts from left to right here. So as we head towards the weekend, you'll see we're going to be more at the top of the falling tide. Wednesday, we're right in the middle of a pulling tide as we head out. Afternoon, 4 p.m. it goes slack, 10 a.m. it goes slack also and starts pulling in. Thursday, where are we? 7 a.m. you're right at about the third mark, third of a mark of the tidal hour, right? Probably in about the 4 hour change of it. So remember, tides run in 12 hour shifts, so every 6 hours they shift. What's that mean? That means it drops for 6 hours and then it rises for 6 hours. So here you're in about 1.5 to 2 hours in. Thursday morning, Friday morning, you're almost right at the top of it, but it'll be pulling to get out. Great trolling outside, great fishing outside those inlets and those jetties. Great stuff. You've got lots of water flow, lots of sediment, lots of little fish eating, and brings in the big fish. And here we go. Saturday, again, you're at the top of the tide, which means Sunday, you're going to be perfect to get out, and the tide will start pulling by the time you get out there and get set up and get rolling. There we had it. All right, folks. It's been great. I just want to invite everyone. One more time, if you have not done it, if you have Facebook, go on ahead. This is the Facebook page. We're up over 700 members right now. Feel free. Every Monday, I make a little, embellishment posts, post your catches. This is how we make this report happen. And we had a solid report from everybody this weekend. Great stuff. And I just had a feeling that the fishing was going to be great, and it was on fire this weekend. So if you haven't, join the South Florida Saltwater Fishing Report group on Facebook. Send in a request, answer a few questions. It's simple. What's your favorite fish? And do you agree to my rules? The rules are simple. No advertisements, no YouTube videos, just reporting what you caught so that everybody can be informed. We're not asking for your fishing spots. We're just saying, hey, this is what I caught. This is where it was. Maybe what it bit, maybe how deep it was. Anything is great and helpful. And also, if you care to, go ahead and subscribe to this YouTube channel. Love the support. All right, folks. Been one for the record books. I had fun. Hope you did too. Till next Tuesday, South Florida Saltwater Fishing Report, going wherever the cool wind takes us.